Puellatus in Bethlehem, alleluia. Unde gaudet Jerusalem, alleluia, alleluia.
This is a Benedictine monastery of the Subiaco Cassinese congregation. It's one of the oldest congregations within the Benedictine Federation. There is the Swiss, the Brazilian, German, American, English. But this is the Subiaco Cassinese congregation. We are Benedictine monks, and Benedictines are the original black monks. We wear black robes, and we have a long history dating back from St. Benedict, 480 AD. And we follow the rule that he created over his life of living as a solitary at first and then living in community, the first time being rather unsuccessful, and then developed rules for how to live in community. And what we have now are the 73 chapters of the Rule of St. Benedict. And we are... we are monks, and we follow his rule. We take vows that are obedience, stability, obedience meaning obedience to the abbot, and obedience to the rule, stability being stability to place and community. So I'm here for life. That's my intention. That's my commitment. That may not be so, but that's my intention. I mean, who knows, I may be transferred, I might go to another monastery because there might be a need there or whatever else. But stability means you are committed to place and a community. And the last is conversatio, which is a change of life. Well, we don't do anything. No, I'm just joking. I'm just joking. I mean, to the world, we don't do anything. I mean, prayer is, you know, in a secular context is not seen as, you know, a profitable activity. I mean, but you would be so surprised. And this is where work can be a blessing for me, because I receive so many letters, hundreds of letters a week from people asking for prayers, people donating to the monastery. And one theme which is consistent throughout these letters is, thank you for what you do. Thank you for doing this for us. Thank you for being there. Well, the monastery came to be because of the vision of Father Elred Wall. He was a monk at Portsmouth Abbey for a long time during the 50s, and he came out here and he found this ranch. And it was about 144 acres or so. And he said, this is the place where I'd like to be. And so he and two other monks came out. This is in 1964, and established the monastery somewhere around July, close to the feast of St. John the Baptist. You choose to accept this call because you're chosen or called by God. I tell friends and family, I mean, no one chooses to live in a 10 by 10 by 10 box in the middle of the desert, no matter how beautiful it is, of their own volition. They have to be called to that, and God calls you to this life. I mean, you're here to praise God, but you're here also to be a part of this creation, beautiful creation around me, and help it collaborate in that creative process with God. And monks of their own proclivities and interests choose certain things. I've always been interested in bees, and lo and behold, the opportunity came to me and I took it. And I've learned the subtle distinction between self-sufficient and self-sustaining. Self-sustaining basically would be, we have everything we need here to live. You know, we can make our own sausage, or we have our own milk. We do have eggs here that we do eat, and as the pollinator in the monastery, I'm the beekeeper, we do make some honey, but not enough to live on all year round. That is self-sufficiency, I mean, to a point, you know, and we rely heavily on the generosity of our guests who come and visit with us, and our donors and benefactors. Self-reliant is not what we are. We're not self-reliant. We cannot do this alone. We need the help of others. We receive people from all different walks of life here at the monastery on retreat when we are open post-pandemic. You don't have to be Catholic to come and stay the night or to retreat here at the monastery. We are mindful of our visitors when they're here, not to impose on them. I mean, they're welcome to eat with us if they wish. We just provide a place for them to stay. And also, too, they're not obligated to come to any of our offices. You could just come to the monastery, and some do, and just stay in their cells. And that has been a refreshing experience for them. Others enter into our day. They go to our offices, they work with us, they eat with us. They try to live a monastic life when they're here. So my role as guest master is one to provide a comfortable and safe, and when I mean safe, I mean not just from untoward activity, but safe in terms of the world, unhurried, not bothered, not noisy, not frenetic, a safe environment for guests where they can listen and hear and see what it is God is saying to them, who God is to them. I think as Thomas Merton said, you know, you're a monk, but you are here for the world, and you cannot be separate from the world, although you are separating yourself for contemplation. But what's so surprising to me sometimes is, from my vantage point here, in one of the most remote monasteries in the country, if not the world, for some people, I have a more lucid view of problems than they do when they're up close and in them. And I attributed that to a grace, maybe, but also to the silence and the time to think about things and to see them as they are and not be distracted. So we are connected, but then again, we aren't connected. We're in of the world, but not in the world. Currently, we have 30 monks here. I say 30 approximately because some monks are away on leave. Ages range from 24 to 94 years of age, representing probably about 7 countries, if not more. Anyone who's lived in a family will know, I think Tolstoy said it, all happy families are the same, but unhappy families are unhappy in their own unique way. And basically, you're dealing with human beings. You're dealing with different ages. You're dealing with different cultures, different languages. There is bound to be tensions and conflict. But that is the very reason why you are seeking Christ through community. One of the desert fathers, I can't remember which exactly, it said, you know, yeah, it's great that you're living out in the desert alone and worshiping God and praising Jesus, but whose feet will you wash? And so what that tells us is, you know, you need other human beings in which to be a Christian, you know. We pray simply because Jesus prayed, and Jesus was God. If Jesus took the time to pray, if he took the time to escape to places like this, mountainous, difficult to reach, and spend time with God to pray, then that sets the example. We follow Jesus, and we follow his example. And we pray for the world. We pray for the church that's visible here with us on Sundays and during our offices, and the invisible church, those people who are not able to go to Mass, those people who are dead, those people who are the church penitent in purgatory, triumphant, the angels, the saints. We pray with and all of them. That is what we do. To the world, it's nothing. But to those who believe and those who understand, it's everything.
Deo dicamus gratia.